Welcome to the presentation of stroke localization. My name is Yifan. I will be presenting this topic together with Dr. Pang Yihao. We are both from National Neuroscience Institute. The objective of this session includes physical signs and clinical syndrome relevant to stroke. Correlate the physical findings with neuroanatomy and vascular supply. Enhance understanding of localizations. Basic neurological examination technique is not in the scope. The presentation will be divided into the anatomy of motor and sensory tract, clinical syndrome and stroke localization according to clinical presentation and correlate with vascular supply. Stroke is a vascular event that happens hyperacutely. There is an acute infarct lesion affecting certain tracts in central nervous system, producing the symptoms and signs. As listed are the presenting signs of stroke. It is important to identify the signs. This can help to localize the site of the infarct, determine the vessel involved, and subsequently plan the investigation and management. The list is not exhaustive, but it covers the common to less common signs encountered in clinical practice. Generally, the signs can be divided into number 1, anterior circulation infarct and posterior circulation infarct. Number 2, cortical signs and lacunar syndromes. In subsequent slides, we will explain the signs and syndromes with explanation on corresponding neuroanatomy for understanding on localizations.
Before learning on localization, one should familiar with understanding of the anatomy and physiology on the nervous system and its blood supply. The long tracts consist of corticospinal tracts, mainly motor tracts, spinal thalamic tracts, which mainly sensory tracts, and posterior column tracts. The efferent pathway, also known as descending pathway, involves motor tracts, which originate from brain or brainstem, descending down to spinal cord to control motor neuron. Some of the efferent pathway are pyramidal cortical tract, extrapyramidal, and cerebellar pathway. Picture on the right hand corner demonstrate cortical spinal tract that originate from primary motor cortex. It passes through the internal capsule, enter the cerebral peduncle in the midbrain, then to Pons and medulla. The fibers then decussate and descend into the spinal cord and terminates in the ventral horn. From there, the lower motor neuron go to supply the muscle of the body. The efferent pathway is also known as ascending pathway that involves sensory tracts. It carries sensory modalities from the skin in the spinal cord. The spinal thalamic tracts decussate at 2 to 3 spinal segments above the entry. It then ascends up to thalamus and ends at the somatosensory cortex of the postcentral gyrus. There are also other tracts such as posterior column and spinocerebellar tract. Every tract from and to the brain pass through the brainstem. The additional feature of brainstem is it consists of 10 pairs of cranial nuclei. And importantly, reticular formation, which regulates sleep and wakefulness and cardiorespiratory control. The diagram shows 3 major parts of brainstem, namely midbrain, pons, and medulla. They consist of different cranial nuclei, arranged in pairs. Except trochlear nerve, all cranial nerves have motor and sensory supply to ipsilateral part of head. The long tracts are arranged in different regions in each part. Infarct is caused by occlusion of the large vessels such as posterior cerebral arteries, basilar artery, and vertebral arteries. Its branches, such as posterior inferior cerebellar artery, anterior inferior cerebellar artery, and perforators. The infarct lesion usually involved the nucleus and its vesicles and the long tracts, producing classical cross signs.
Next few slides, we will discuss on the syndrome of stroke, namely Lacunar syndromes, cortical syndromes, and brainstem syndromes. This is concurrently discussed on localizations and vascular supply. Let's begin with Lacunar syndrome. As per the picture shown on the slide, typically we have six Lacunar syndromes, such as pure motor, pure sensory, sensory motor, dysarthral clumsy hand, ataxic hemiparesis, and hemibalismus or hemichorea. The localizations of Lacunar syndrome is usually at subcortical region and brainstem. This diagram shows the anatomy of small perforators originating from major arteries. The left diagram shows anterior circulation. A is basilar artery. B is thalamus perforators, which originates from the posterior cerebral artery. C is anterior choroidal artery. And E is lenticulostriate arteries, which originate from D, which is middle cerebral artery. At posterior circulation as shown on middle and right diagram, at Pons level for examples, they are A. Midline large median arteries, B. Paramedian penetrators, C. Penetrating arteries into the lateral tegmentum of the pons. The occlusion of the perforators, either along anterior and posterior circulations, may produce Lacunar syndromes.
Next, we are going to talk about hemispheric syndrome. The syndrome consists one or more of the cortical signs. It includes neglect, aphasia, hemianopia, and conjugated gaze deviation. Certain patterns such as brachiofacial and upper limb or lower limb monoparesis are specific to cortical infarcts as well. This is due to distribution of motor homunculus, as shown here, at the coronal view of cerebrum along the precentral gyrus. The trunk and lower limb area are supplied by anterior cerebral artery, whereas upper limb and face are supplied by middle cerebral artery. Middle cerebral artery is the largest artery and supply the largest area of brain. Occlusion at different parts produce combination of certain signs. On the table, there are different depth of arterial occlusion, which each produces different extents of infarcts and hence its clinical manifestations.
Now we move on to the posterior circulation syndrome. They are medullary syndrome, pontine syndrome, midbrain syndrome, cerebellar syndrome, top of the basilar, and lock-in syndrome. As shown on anatomy of posterior circulation, a single basilar artery supply majority of brainstem. Syndromes of basilar artery occlusion can be various, and there is possibility that the sign can be bilateral or generalized. This makes the early diagnosis to be challenging. As listed here, it can have paraplegia, bulbar involvement, and nystagmus. These conjugated eye movement palsies can be presented as classical internuclear ophthalmoplegia, 1.5 syndromes, and isolated cranial nerve 3rd, 4th, and 6th palsies. And lastly, coma or unconsciousness, or even apnea and cardiorespiratory collapse due to extensive reticular formation impairment might occur. It is critical not to miss and to identify early, as prompt treatment will improve morbidity and mortality.
In subsequent few slides, we will show some common brainstem syndromes. As mentioned earlier, most cranial nerve nuclei supply ipsilaterally, but pyramidal and spinothalamic tract decussate below lower medulla, hence lesion in the brainstem, if large extent enough, will produce classic cross signs. The most common clinical encounter syndrome is lateral medullary syndrome. It has dysphagia, dysarthria, dysphonia, absent or impaired gag reflex, and ipsilaterally, it will produce Horner syndrome, fifth cranial nerve palsy, cerebellar sign, and impairment of pain and temperature and touch over the V1 and V2 areas. Contralateral deficits are impaired pain and temperature over the body. Another less common medullary syndrome is medial medullary syndrome. It produces ipsilateral 12th nerve palsy and loss of proprioception and vibration sense. The contralateral deficit is pyramidal weakness. Moving on to Pons are Millard-Gubler syndrome and Marie-Foix syndrome. But these syndromes are rarely seen in clinical practice. Then, certain midbrain syndromes are shown here. The arterial supply of the cerebellum is provided by the posterior circulation and is divided into three arteries. The posterior inferior cerebellar artery arises from the intracranial vertebral artery. The anterior inferior cerebellar artery from the basilar artery, and the superior cerebellar arteries near the basilar artery bifurcation. Cerebellar infarct has its own list of syndrome, as listed there. Please bear in mind, paralysis usually does not occur. Finally, stroke is a clinical diagnosis. Identify a clinical syndrome will help us to localize a lesion. Neurological examination in correlation with imaging helps to localize the stroke syndrome. We hope that you have more understanding on stroke syndrome and localization from this presentation. Thank you and have a nice day.